In this lecture, we're going to be covering off Power Query. Power Query is a powerful tool for transforming all of your data. However, even if your data requires no transformation, it can save you a lot of time if you have to refresh any of your data inside your Excel workbooks. The two most typical ways of refreshing data in Excel is either copy and paste or opening your files and repeating all of your steps. By setting up your workbooks with Power Query, you'll be able to simply click a refresh button to update everything in your models. In Excel 2016, Power Query has now been built into Excel, has moved to the Data tab, and has been renamed to Get Data. In Excel 2010 and Excel 2013, Power Query came as a free add-in from Microsoft and is downloadable from their site. If you're using Excel 2010 or 2013, you can get a link to the Microsoft site for the download in the lecture notes. To use Power Query, we simply come over to Get Data, and we can see here that we can extract data from a number of file formats. Here we have an Excel workbook, a number of different text file formats, databases, from Facebook, or from a number of other sources. For this example, we're going to use a simple text file, which is stored in a CSV file format. We're going to come over to our example file here, employees 2017. And here we can see a preview of our data. To carry out any cleaning or transformation operations on our data, we can click the edit button, but we're going to cover that off in a separate lecture. For now, we're just going to go ahead and click load. You can see here that our data has automatically been added to a table for easy use. Our table has been given a name, employees 2017, which was the name of our file. If I want to generalize this a little bit more, I could rename this so that this table could be reused for data from different periods, say employees 2016 or employees 2018, and still have our name reference make sense throughout our different formulas. Over here, we have the query. This contains the import specifications for getting our data into Excel. The nice thing about this is that anytime our data gets updated, all I have to do is come over here and click the refresh button, and that will refresh. Now, the things to keep in mind here are that, first of all, the data is pointed to a specific file. So if your file name changes, you're going to have to update this. Now, it's quite common in various workflows that your files get renamed with either versions or dates attached to them. To simplify your workflow, I recommend always outputting the file with the same file name into the same location and simply adding an extra copy of the file off into an archive folder, which does contain your date for easy reference to the different files. Now, if you do need to change where this file is pointed to, you can come over here and click Edit. This will take us to the query editor. Most of these options are due with cleaning and transformation, so we'll cover that a little bit later. But for now, you notice over here that we have some properties, including the name of our query. Again, I can adjust this to be something a little bit more generic. Down here, we have all the different steps which are taking place on our data. So the first one here is specifying where our data comes from. Promoted headers basically means that the first row of our data contains the column names. And change type adds these 1.2, ABC, which basically specifies this is a numeric number with decimal places, and these are text fields. So to update the settings for our file location, I can come back up to source. I can click this little cog icon here, which is the settings for this parameter. And I can click browse here to change the file that I'm pointing to. After this has all been adjusted, you can come over here and click OK. Now, if this data doesn't refresh straight away, you can come over here and click Refresh Preview. Now, there's one other setting I want to talk about here, and this is sitting under the Advanced Editor. Clicking on Advanced Editor will take us to a script which has been created for us. One of the settings here, columns equals to 14, basically meant that when we imported our original dataset, it contained 14 columns. Now, the problem with this being part of our import specification is that if we have less columns or more columns, then our data is not going to import correctly. It's quite often where you have a data set and then you realize that you need to add additional columns to it. you go back, add the fields. Now, here, if you ended up with, say, 15 or 16 columns, those would be then truncated down to 14 columns again. This was not actually a problem in Power Query back in Excel 2010 and Excel 2013. However, in Excel 2016, Microsoft has decided to hard code this value as part of the script that's created. To make Power Query more flexible and more easily refreshable, when you update the number of columns in your data sources, come over to here, select columns equals 14, make sure that you also select the comma, and simply press delete. I'm going to click done, and then close and load to exit Power Query. Now, anytime our data is updated, I can simply come and click the refresh button here, or the refresh button up the top here. In another lecture, we're going to cover off data cleaning and transformations using Power Query. However, this right here is the predominant way that I use Power Query. Because I do my data transformations predominantly in R, I think Power Query can be a really great way of loading that data into Excel so that users who only have Excel are able to easily consume and pivot that data, while also being able to refresh the workbook when the data gets updated.